We're back. Ham Radio Now, episode 225 from the ARRL TAPR Digital Communications Conference. This is going to be John Hayes, K7VE, Amateur Radio Voice and Data Network Interconnection. That's what it looks like on their program. And once again, that's not all he's going to be talking about. In fact, that may not be the most interesting thing he's talking about. That depends on your point of view. So we'll get to John in just a moment. Ham Radio Now brought to you by you. If you've been enjoying these TAPR programs, they were expensive to produce, hauling me and a bunch of equipment out to Chicago to record it, and a lot of time to get these prepared to put online. So you can help out. Stop by the website, hamradionow.tv. Click on Arvin's icon. Arvin, A-R-Arvin, A-R-V-I-N. That's the name of the piggy bank over my shoulder. I'll explain how he got that name. If you don't know, I'll explain how he got that name sometime. Maybe the end of this show will be a good time to do that. It'll keep you watching until the very end. Anyway, you click on his icon and you can help us out with a individual contribution through PayPal, which you don't need a PayPal account for. Major credit card will do. Or a monthly contribution through Patreon, and that would be cool. A dollar a month from a lot of people makes it work. It's all we need. Some people do a little bit more who can, but dollar a month is all we need if we get a bunch more people helping out. So let's head to Chicago from last October, the Digital Communications Conference, and see just what kind of trouble John Hayes wants to stir up.
Okay, are we ready there, John? Okay, so I'd like to introduce John Hayes, K7 Victor Echo. He's going to talk about amateur radio voice data network interconnection. Take it away, John.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Good morning.
Okay. Anyone that doesn't know me, this is a little bit of my CV. I'm an IT executive for a company out in Seattle. I got to get this shifted a little bit. I've been in digital communications on ham radio since we were using stone tablets and chisels. So I've been at it for a while. I enjoy it. I'm more of a builder than a talker on the radio, which is surprising for people that know me. Another little point that I share with people is I don't see any of these people because I'm blind on this side, so if there's a question over here and I don't catch you, somebody make a noise. I need a seeing eye dog over there. Okay, so let's jump right into this. This will be fairly high level. The depth of this takes a long time. For those that aren't familiar with digital voice, I have a presentation that I do. Thank you. I needed a little sugar. Brian's taking care of me. So I'll do a presentation tomorrow. It's on the internet. If you don't really want to see me in person, you can see it. It's a replay of that. Bud, what did you say? About 5,000 people have watched it on the internet. So there's a possibility that one or two people have seen it here, but we'll do it in person with Q&A. So we've got this landscape. I've got to adjust this just a little bit. Of digital communications out there in the amateur radio space. Brian talked about a little thing we've got going out in the Seattle area called HamWAN. At Atlanta, I did a presentation about Net44 and how it kind of languished, and there were some reasons for that. Again, we, as hams, like to take something and figure out the hardest way to do it, and we were doing that with HamWAN, and it had kind of died on the vine. Well, it's having a revival over the last few years. People are getting Net44 address space, old AmperNet, but we have some high-speed solutions to that. Some people are doing mesh networking, some are using Canopy, some In Europe, they have the HamNet, and these are high-speed networks. In the Seattle area now, we have varying data rates, but 10 to 50 megabits can be made available over RF, and a lot of our repeater sites are now starting to hook up to this network that runs up at 5.8 gigahertz and hooking up their IRLP or their D-Star or their Fusion or whatever through that. And that's pretty much done with off-the-shelf consumer equipment that have been repurposed into the ham band. So that's one category. We've kind of got a mid-tier that has languished a little bit, starting to come back. The 56K WA7 DSY modems, if you had a 28 megahertz IF that you could put them on. ICOM has their ID1, the UDRX is coming. HamNet has some custom built modems in Europe that they use. Here in the United States, you can start using that bandwidth at 219 megahertz in band. How many people here know we have a ham band at 219 megahertz? Yeah, we do. It's a megahertz wide. You can put 10 100 kilohertz channels in there and run 56 kilobits data through them. Pretty sweet, huh? I have a hard time fitting that into some other bands. The higher speed stuff's running up in the microwave bands. And then we've got a lot of low speed stuff. How many here still hear 1200 baud packet on the radio once in a while? Most of it's APRS, but it's out there. There's some other things running. In the past, you've heard, and Seattle, we seem to have a lot of different things. We have a 9600 baud repeater network up there with packet on, which could expand. There were some 192 products. There's some other things, mostly running AX25 and various applications that you see there. There's a bunch of digital voice technologies that are coming on. And there are reasons why you want to do digital voice. And there are some people that don't think that that's real radio, but that's OK because some of us have moved on to a new generation. So I break it into basically two categories. There are those that use vocoders. And a lot of people interchange the term vocoder and codec interchangeably. They are different. Codecs in general, the purpose of them is to take an audio sample and compress it. And typically that means by losing some information and trying to simulate it and so on, but you're still basically taking the original signal and just using various compression techniques to get there. A vocoder, on the other hand, and Codec 2 does this, as well as the Ambi products, does actually speech recognition. Speech is made up of things called diphthongs, and it encodes those in such a way that the or whatever you're using to structure a word is just represented by some numeric value, and then adds in additional numeric values that handle things like pitch, attack, decay, and so on. And that number gets sent over the network. And on the other side, the vocoder takes that number or series of numbers and reconstructs the pitch, attack, delay, right? And so you hear the voice on the other end, and it sounds reasonably close to the original voice. I can hear two people who I know well and tell when one's Bill and one's Peter, right? It's close enough. And the other thing that it does is because it is doing, quote, speech recognition, I'm sure the theorists wouldn't express it the same way, it eliminates a lot of background noise. If you try to play music through one of these, it's awful. Okay. Whereas a compressor would give you something that sort of sounded like, you know, it's all about the bass. So the earliest vocoders were using MB. That's what you find in P25 in phase one. You've got the Ambi Plus, which is what D-Star uses. You have Ambi 2 Plus, or Plus 2, which is what DMR Fusion, DPMR, Phase 2, so on, are all using at the current time. And then we've got Codec 2. And then the other category is the ones that are truly using codecs. And they're just taking analog voice, compressing it down, sending it over the internet, and decompressing it at the other end. And that includes Echolink, IRLP, All-Star, and then there's other things out there. So we got two general categories of people. There are the people that like to expand the art. They're the experimenters. They figure out new modulation techniques. They figure out new protocols. They figure out all the different components that need to go together to make these systems work. And they're kind of your experimenter types of hams. And then we have the people that consume it, the people that use it. They'll have an interest in what we're doing, but they have a goal in mind. That is, get this piece of communication from this location to this location. That's really what they care about. The mechanism, they may join a camp and be an evangelist for this technology or that technology, but what they really care about is they want to have their emergency services net, or they want to call Aunt Mabel, or whatever it is, and that's what they really care about. So, all digital communications are based on what I call the generic transmission unit. And if you take all of the things we do over the air that are digital communications, or what we do over the network, they all follow this basic same formula. Excuse me. So there's the header stuff. There's some sort of addressing going on. There's sometimes command and control. This is your what sub protocol I'm using or something. Then there's the payload, and there's some kind of ending that lets you know you're done talking. Whether it's data or voice, you gotta have something that says, I'm done, beep, whatever it is. In data transmission, everything outside the payload is superfluous, really, to the end user. They're interested in the payload. The payload, as we know going over time, may be yet another generic data transmit unit, and it gets unwrapped, and there's a payload inside of it, and you recurse and recurse and you recurse, and you finally get down to the piece of information that people are really interested in. Voice is the same exact thing. It's the payload that's important, and every one of these protocols or methodologies, basically you have coded voice, and you have a little bit of data and control interleaved with it continuously. And that continues in a stream over and over and over again, and that is the payload inside of the transmission unit. Okay? Just doing some ground setting here. So, we take all of that technology, and we try to satisfy the need of the user. And in the past, excuse me, in the past we've had, I use the term the cowboy developer. A guy gets a great idea, and he's really good at a couple of things, whatever it is. He's really good at making bits go back and forth into a modem and sending them over the radio, or It's really good at integrating the Windows file system into a program that sends it over the network. And then he thinks he can do everything, and he builds a top-to-bottom application. Doesn't understand user interface, doesn't understand some aspect of that stack, and goes out and creates something that's 95% just like everything else out there and 100% incompatible. We've heard that before. So sometimes they do it out of necessity. Doesn't exist. It's not available for an economical point that would be useful in amateur radio. They have personal preferences that aren't satisfied by the previous implementations they see out there. Sometimes they have personal reasons. They just don't like the guy that wrote it before. Right? Anyone belong to a ham radio club? Anyone have politics in their ham radio club? Anyone have factions in their ham radio club? Okay, so you take that to a global scale, and there's a lot of opinions out there. And you know, they say you put two hams in a room and you can get three opinions. So there are reasons it happens. Some of them are good, some of them aren't. Often these applications have no idea what a standard is, much less try to make it standardized so it can operate with something else. Sometimes we have people that build things to a standard. What's this name of this organization here? Tucson Amateur Packet Radio. One of the first things they did was create a standard for doing packet radio over the air. Little protocol called AX25. A lot of people were able to create applications that used AX25. And the interesting thing was, is they could talk to each other. It was really kind of cool. It was kind of novel. It was kind of new. There are others out there. The JAR came up with the D-Star, which ICOM implemented, and now Flex is implemented, and other people are implementing. There's one we're going to hear about this afternoon, ARDOP, with Mike and Matthew and John. They're going to come up. I'm really looking forward to that. APRS. Bob kind of drove that, Bob Baringa, but it's a standard that people can write applications to. There are several infrastructures that use it. And those are the things that really add value to the community as a whole. There are some vendor specification ones. Fusion has written a really good specification for a digital protocol. It's somewhat related to some of the industry standards, but they've made it open. Someone else can implement it. That's, you know, there's not a restriction on that. PacTor, sometimes they're closed. But at standard, you can have more than one implementation. And then the one that I think is great is when we can adopt an industry standard that a lot of people have done engineering and worked on, if there aren't licensing constraints around it that prevent us from using it. You know, TCP/IP, anybody can implement that, that's fine. MPEG, properly done, there's a license. DMR, properly done, there's a license. There are other ways to get those industry standards. So, this is the area where a lot of people are making a lot of progress in implementation and integration now. In the voice area, there's two basic things that you do. One is point-to-point communication and group communication. So you could have conferencing bridges or talk groups, linking two systems together. So there's some basic ground rules that we'll play with here. In point-to-point linking or routing, if you're talking to the same system, just use what it's got. I mean, it exists, it works, you can stay within that particular technology, and have your link operating, no problem whatsoever. But if you're going between systems, then you got a problem because they're 95% the same and 100% incompatible. So there's a couple of design principles. If they're using the same coding scheme for voice, don't take it down to baseband audio and bring it back up again. Just keep it in that mode, no transcoding. If the surrounding protocol is different, a good example of this would be DMR, say, fusion half rate, you just have to change the coding around it to be cross-network compatible, but the voice can go straight through, okay? So that's an approach. If there is no shared, again, don't go to down to analog baseband if you don't have to, but often you do. And there's kind of a thing we discovered in network computing. I worked in network computing for a number of years, and some processors, the bytes are reversed versus other processors. The network has a certain order to the bytes and stuff. And in the early days of computer networking, we figured out that there's a principle that should be applied, and that is the receiver makes it right. So if you natively transfer your data with reverse bytes, the receiver knows that you're sending them in reverse bytes and switches them to the order that they need and then pass it on to their program. So it's just a design principle I like to use in these types of systems. So in conferencing systems, typically you've got a transmitter and you've got a bunch of receivers. Again, if it's the same system, say DSAR, and you're going into a reflector, there's nothing you have to do. The technology exists. You just send it in, it comes out, works great. Same with ARRLP and some of these others, rooms in the fusion space. But when we get into the crossband, you may run into a circumstance where you've got a user community that's all using, say, DMR, and another user community that's using DSTAR, and you've got another user community that's using Fusion, and you've got another user community that's using Codec 2, and then you've got all the guys that are on analog, and you want to build a net where everyone can talk to each other. So we have to build a network, a system that allows these systems to talk to each other. And I have a few ideas on that. One is that for any given technology, you have a conference room for that technology. So you have a DMR conference bridge, and you have a Fusion conference bridge, and you have a IRLP reflector room. And then those rooms or bridges talk to each other. And so something comes in on DMR, it goes immediately out to all the DMR users. It goes through a bridge over to, say, a Fusion conference room. It follows those rules. We'll have a couple diagrams here in a minute. And that same message gets repeated in that second conference and goes out to all the users that are connected to it, and a third and a fourth and so on. So, stepping back just a little bit, in the analog over digital transport, some of these use the same codec, some of them don't. But all you really have to do is get a path from one to the other. So there are bridges out there, for example, that some camps don't like that connect Echolink to IRLP or to ALLSTAR, which is an Astra SIP-based system. You just have to route between them, pretty straightforward. there's really no metadata that you're sending along. You're not sending GPS coordinates along with it or short messaging service or anything like that. It's pretty straightforward. In digital voice modes, you've got some that have their own encoding, and I've listed a few here. D-Star is using AMBI Plus, the older version of AMBI. So it's kind of in an island by itself because there's not a lot of other systems out there using that particular version of AMBI. There's Codec 2, which is new and open and innovative, but it's its own encoding. So it's kind of out there by itself. For some reason, people want to buy the old boat anchors that the agencies are trying to get rid of, and they don't have a boat to hook them to, so they try to put them on the air. And they're using the old P25 format, not really advancing anything, but they use an older version of vocoder called IMBY. So they're their own thing. And there will be other things that come along, and that's good. We should be experimenting, we should be learning, we should be getting new technologies all the time. But in this case, a lot of these protocols have addressing, routing, all those things you do with the network, and you've got to translate those, but you also have to transcode the vocoding. So you have to take it out, and typically between these, you got to go clear back down to analog and then re-encode it, which is lossy. It's not too bad. We've done it. We've done it back to back with some things, and you can get the communication through, but it's not ideal. Then you have the digital voice modes that are using the same vocoding. So if I take a fusion half rate, a DMR, a DPMR, a P25 phase 2 half rate, the AMBI stream can be transferred between these systems as is. They're all using the same standard. So all the real effort is in transcoding the remodeling the addressing and routing information. So in DMR you use a number, in DPMR I don't know that they have really good networking. P25 has a number-based scheme, Fusion has a call sign-based scheme, and you have to have lookup tables to figure out if I'm on DMR and I want to call WA7FUS, hi Peter, there has to be something that says, if I send it to this pseudo address, 317921 on DMR, that really means WA7FUS on D-Star, or in this case it would be Fusion, and figure out the path to him and then just take that AMBI and transport it. Also, most of these protocols have some metadata, GPS coordinates, short messages, something else. As best as you can, you want to transfer those as well, and sometimes they represent those things in different ways. So it's a software problem. Anyone in here write software? A few? Yeah. Yeah, you know, you need to get out those programming skills and do some stuff. Now, there is an outlier here. Because of the full rate in Fusion, you'd still have to do transcoding. But otherwise, similar type of an issue. So every one of these protocols is a variation of this same theme. I have voice bits and I have data bits. Who in here uses DMR? Nobody. Kenny does. And did you know you can run IP over DMR?
Motorola radio does that.
Yep. Not too many people do it, but you can do it. Fusion, you can take the whole 9600 baud and dedicate it to data. Okay? But most of the protocols You have to pick. D-Star, they've got two data rates you can use for data. Codec 2 has some bits for data, right, Bruce?
They're actually not part of Codec 2, but yes.
Yes. The implementations. Yes. So we need to be able to handle those. So this task is to bring both voice and the metadata from one system to another. So this very complicated diagram here shows that when you're going from like vocoder systems, you have to handle the address, the routing, the metadata, and then just relay the voice frame on the left. If you're going to between, say, an analog system and a digital system, you have to do the conversion, and there's two representations here. See that little arrow jumping up and down? You've either got to go from one digital coder to another, or from an analog codec to a vocoder and back through the bridge. So the goal is, as I said earlier, is to get it so that you can interoperate between these systems. There are camps in every one of them that will scream bloody murder because you're not keeping everything pure. They don't want to talk to anybody but themselves. But as a group, we need to increase our ability to intercommunicate between systems. Then we go back and we say there's a generic data transmission unit. Doesn't matter what it is, AX25, TCP/IP, something that someone will yet design. I can envision a over-the-air protocol that has nothing but a leading header, a destination, a source, and a closing flag, and nothing else. And that destination may be broadcast without anything wrapping it, except for some sync bits at the front, which would be more efficient, frequency-wise, amount of data going through. But again, it's all about the payload. And if you're moving the payload from one technology to another, that's fine. It's the the surrounding programs that have to figure out how to get from the one encapsulating technology to the other. And we've done this for 40 years. Anyone ever hear of AX over IP? AX25 over IP? IP over AX25. It's a encapsulation, right? D-Star runs Ethernet frames inside of D-Star frames. And then they put them inside of Ethernet frames and send them over a TCP/IP stack over the internet if you're doing the data protocol. So again, ultimately, it's all about the payload. So as coders and network builders, we have to figure out how to get the payload from one location to another. So that payload can be anything. It can be voice, as we looked at in the voice example. It could be image. It could be files, data, command and control, authentication, metadata, telemetry, or a combination of all the above. And one of the things Brian often talks about, he didn't talk about this morning, was we really need to think about it in terms of it's all data. It doesn't matter all this other stuff, it's the payload, it's the data that's important. And we can think about big pipes, medium-sized pipes, and little pipes. And what's appropriate to go over each one of those, and how do we get the data from one to another? The rest is detail for the environment that you're running in, okay? If you're running on HF, you've got all kinds of QRN and QRM and other queues that sit there and mess up your signal. That's for the lower level to worry about. It's the payload you need to get through. We run into the same thing at the other end. They've discovered a new propagation issue in Seattle with HamWeb. It's called Amazon fade. Anyone want to take a guess at what Amazon fade is? Not Kenny. So the way they built HamWeb is they have a whole bunch of 58 gig links and sector antennas. It's built like a cell network, right? And these sector antennas, and then there's backhaul dishes and so on. And one of the key paths in downtown Seattle goes between two locations, and Amazon's building a building, and there's a little outcropping on it, and it drops the signal, I forget, 20 dB or something like that.
No, it goes through the middle
of it. Does it? Yeah, well, Kenny works at Amazon, so it's his fault. So they get this fade from construction going on, so they're having to come up with another path for the bits to go. But those are the kinds of problems you have to solve at a level. But what do people care about? They care about the payload, and we got to get the payload through. So moving forward, what I'm requesting each of us to think about, and each of us in our own groups, is working more together, taking things like the ARRL TAPR, I can't keep those letters straight, to come up with common ways to talk with each other so that we can be 100% compatible and only 95% not usable. Kind of reverse the numbers there. Let's build things that can be stacked on top of each other and let the people that do certain things best do those things. I'm really excited to hear about what Bruce has been doing with the web interface to radios. I really want to see what he's accomplished there. I know he's solved the problem of using a web interface to transfer audio back and forth to the user and some command and control stuff. I think that's cool, and I know one of Bruce's goals is that can be bolted onto a bunch of lower lane stacks. One of you might be a great UI designer that can take what Bruce has done and make it pretty, because we need things that are pretty. The good folks at Flex have opened up much lower level access to modulation schemes and so on using an API that they have. Some of the other vendors are getting ready to give us better APIs into their systems. And we should reward those vendors. Those vendors that will open up so that we can get more involved at different levels in this stack of communications are furthering amateur radio. And I know I work for Northwest Digital Radio as my night job. That's totally our goal, is to be open and allow people to experiment and do new things with our products and our technologies. Already said most of that. One of my pet projects that was alluded to earlier, it's a Raspberry Pi hat. You plug it in, it's got connections, you hook it into a repeater, in this case the DR1X. It allows you to run multiple modems, could be a 9600 baud packet modem and have a 9600 baud in a voice channel packet system. It could be D-Star, it could be Fusion, it could be a bunch of other things, as well as analog. It has a built-in chip for doing those modems, and it's all under software control. The PI2 is a four-core processor, is able to handle the DSP and so on to make this all happen. So it's a good thing if you understand QR codes, that'll take you to it. And we're to the questions.
Hi there, just a couple things. So on the slide you showed an over-the-air packet.
Mm-hmm.
I would suggest that the CRC should not be over the payload, but just on the header, because then you can't take advantage of forward error correction that's within the payload.
Right, that works for data. For voice, you don't know when it's going to end, so you don't know when you're going to get your CRC.
Right, but you can have the length and the header still nonetheless, but yeah. To have the maximum flexibility. And I just have, I'm a little confused on something, so maybe you can help here. Now, you talked about bringing the digital systems together so we have interoperability, and I agree with you that we don't want to be, you know, we want to be inclusive, right?
Right.
And it seems to me that the conference bridge or whatever is a good way to do that. By the way, I don't know that you need separate, you know, you don't need the bridging because you should just be able to figure out what's coming in. But I don't under, but my problem with something like the product that plugs into the DR1 is that's isolating, because if you have somebody with a fusion radio on the repeater, they won't hear the D-star. And so I think it's better that each repeater have its dedicated modes, if you understand what I mean. But
I 100% agree with you. Putting digital and analog on the same frequency is a terrible, terrible, terrible idea. But it's genius marketing.
Pull the DAR club off the ground.
Yeah. Yeah. It allows you to replace the analog repeater and put digital on it. And if you're going to do it for one protocol, why not multiple? I mean, they're just access points, right? Anyone else?
Hey. So that just to expound on that a little bit, I think what we need to see here is a separation of necessarily these voice and repeater linking networks from the underlying mode that they're operating in. Because right now you have a network for D-Star, you have a network for P25, written with proprietary stuff, even worse. And none of these guys can talk to anyone else. We're violating the, you know, the real reason we have ham radio is so anybody can talk to anybody else. And I think the term for this would be we have a bit of a balkanization of modes right now.
Anyone else?
Yeah, we've been talking about standardizing, you know, in the radio space from a conventional, you know, land mobile radio perspective. However, the biggest land mobile radio systems out there right at the moment are all the cell phone systems. And I was wondering, you know, is there any correlation at all or relationship standards-wise?
I'm sorry, I didn't quite follow the question.
Okay, so we've got, you know, AT&T has their system, Verizon has theirs,
right.
I think a third one in Europe possibly, and are any of what we're doing right now related to any of the standards they're currently, radios are using for digital communications?
So ours is more closely related to what's used in the land mobile side. It's a similar problem. Worldwide, the most popular digital voice technology is GSM. And some of the US networks have adopted that and some have not. Some are using other technologies that have been around for a while. You also have different spectrums depending on what service you're on and what part of the world you're on. But ultimately, they all come back together, much like the conference bridge idea that I was talking about, that there is a meeting place where they can come together. And in the telephony space, that's the PTSN, the public telephony switched network. And we need similar types of technologies in what we're doing. I hope that somewhat addresses. We do need to move on with the schedule. I'm around, so.
Thank you very much, John.
Okay, thank you, John. Thank you, guys. So that's it for this episode, and we'll be getting to Bruce Perrins in just a minute. You won't want to miss that. I promised I would tell you what the history of Arvin's name was. So I'm going to go to my old website. It's Ham Radio Now originated as Amateur Radio Video News, ARVN. And I produced a bunch of DVDs and stuff with that name. And it was mildly successful, but I didn't produce very much. Not very often, you know, one DVD or two a year for a couple of years. And then Ham Radio Now was born from that and, you know, a program a week or more on average. So, but ARVN, Amateur Radio Video News, is still sort of the parent, well, not the parent company, because it's not a company, just a name I invented. I'm incorporated. The incorporation is under my business name, Pierce 10 Inc.
Wait.
We haven't had a cat visit us in some time. So here's Maui Mouse. Where's a good camera for the mouse? Oh, not that one. Not that one. Yeah, sort of shows the mouse. Sort of shows the mouse. We need a mouse cam. Can I get a mouse cam? Maybe. Mouse cam. The mouse cam is out of focus. I'm not sure what the problem is. So, we'll just do the best we can with this shot. And I'll put the mouse where she likes to go, up on my shoulder. There you go. All right. So ARVN, which a lot of folks pronounced Arvin. I never called it that, but people who watched the program started calling it Arvin. And so when I adopted this little piggy bank, he didn't have a name. And at some point, I decided to call him Arvin. A-R-V-I-N is his name. So stop by Ham Radio. It's a long way to get around to say stop by hamradionow.tv. Or you can go to Arvin, ARVN.tv, if you want. So it'll get you here, which, you know, kind of useless. And help us out financially, either through PayPal or Patreon. I've explained this several times. I think you've got it by now. So let's get on to Bruce Perens in a moment. In the next episode, not right now. You'll have to click a few buttons to watch Bruce, or maybe your YouTube will auto-forward you to it. I don't know. But it'll be in the next episode, so we'll clear this one out. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Thanks for watching. 73 over in Mouse.